the rostrum in order to commence the keynote lecture.
I would like to thank God for this day, and in particular for blessing, comforting, and watching over Mrs. Tracy Toko, their children, grandchildren, since a dark day in August 2002. I want to thank all of you for coming in such large numbers to honor and celebrate the day that took our life. We, his friends, fondly call him Willie. That is the name which God has called him, Willie. Today marks 15 years since death robbed us of a dear, distinguished, and much loved son of West Nile and Uganda. Toko went to be with the Lord on Sunday, 18th August 2002. It was a tragic day, a big wrong, and a big loss for the people of West Nile and Uganda as a whole. I'd like to thank the organizing committee for this historic event, for a job well done, and for the opportunity they have accorded me to deliver this memorial lecture, which I have titled The Enduring Legacy of Brigadier Gerald Wilson Toko. The author of the book of Ecclesiastes wrote a classic poem which is recorded in chapter 3 of that book. It is titled A Time for Everything. Part of that poem reads, "Everything happens in this world at the time God chooses. He says the time for birth and the time for death. The time for planting and the time for pulling out. The time for killing and the time for healing. The time for hair tearing down and the time for building. He says the time for sorrow and the time for joy. The time for mourning and the time for dancing." In chapter 90 of the book of Psalms, which is titled Of God and Man, the psalmist wrote, and I quote, "70 years is all we have, 80 if we are strong. Yet all they bring us is trouble and sorrow. Life is soon over and we are gone. Who has felt the full power of their anger? Who knows what fear and fury bring? Teach us how short life is so that we may become wise. Teach us how short life is so that we may become wise." Brigadier Toko was born on 1st January 1943. He was only 59 years old when he went to the Lord. Sooner or later, all of us gathered here today will follow him. May the Lord teach us how short life is and give us the wisdom to live peacefully and productively. When a close friend or relative passes on, it is a wake-up call that you and me could be next. I was made aware of this rather pleasant reality by my late father, the Reverend Enoch Ayala, who was an Anglican priest, and in fact was a colleague of Brigadier Toko's father, the late Joshua Adebo. They both served what was then called the Native Anglican Church in Adinga County, where I was born, by the way, but that was Ontario. During the 1950s, Joshua was based at the lake, which I believe is now the headquarters of Adinga Archdiaconate. My father was headmaster of a school called Wolo Primary School, which was founded by the Native American Church. My father often warned mourners while officiating funerals, and there were many at least who officiated. He always warned mourners to be prepared at all times, because anybody could be next. But most of us believe, behave, or think death will somehow spare us when we're still alive, especially when you're young. I tell you, it will not. So we had better be prepared than sorry when the day of reckoning beckons. As believers in God and the risen Christ, we must not fear death, because Jesus has already conquered death when he arose from the grave on his. Just like a seed of grain must die in order to germinate, to grow into a crop and bear fruits which will endure, death is the gateway to new and eternal life with our Father in heaven. Our Lord, be in second. I met and got to know Willie, or Together Toko, in 1961, before independence, when I went to South Summit Baker School in Google for Senior 1. Toko was then in Senior 4, and there was no LFU yet in Senior Baker School. It was virtually the only second school in the entire northern province. During those school days, Toko was really showing strong leadership qualities and carried himself with dignity, which he did up then. He was a role model and a mentor for many of us in other students. Toko was a house prefect, was the captain of the school cricket team, and he also excelled in the high jump. During the colonial regime, cricket was a popular game which was rated almost equal to football. Even here in Arua, there is the cricket pitch which is now the where the market, part of the market is. So the cricket. At a personal level, Toko was friendly, approachable, and a gentleman. And he had a keen sense of humor and a knack for cracking jokes, which stay with him to them. Toko left Sasana Baker School in December 61 after obtaining a Cambridge school certificate. Today, in the good of Lucy. Toko's sister, Mrs. Mildred Adjani, when I was a student, she was called Ruth Yotar, I don't know whether she's here. Ruth was my classmate in the 1950s at Wolo Primary School. And then we sat playing together with her in 1958. You can't believe it. Almost 60 years ago. 1958. And I tell you, our standards were very high. I'm not guessing. Most Ugandans know Brigadier Toko as the vice chairman of the military commission, which ruled Uganda from July 85. To January 1986. He was also the Minister of Defense during that Tito Okello regime, and he was leader of the Uganda delegation to the Nairobi peace talks between the Military Commission and the National Resistance Army. Prior to holding the position of Vice President, basically that was what he was, Brigadier Toko was general manager of Uganda Airlines from 1979 to 1985. And that was really the golden age of QU, as he was called. And before that, he was director general of the defunct East African Airways from 1974 to 1976. Because, as was said earlier, prior to that, he was the commander of the Uganda Air Force. As you may know, the Eastern Community collapsed in 1977, the first Eastern Community. Now, Togo's tenure as Director General of the South African Airways Corporation was at the end of 1976. And to everybody's surprise, then President Amin declared Togo persona non grata. And he told him that Togo, your duty is over, but you can't come to Uganda. And that forced him and his family to go into exile in Pittsburgh in the US from 1976 to 1979. And during that same period, I was working at the Uganda Mission New York, which was not far from Pittsburgh. Togo returned to Uganda after the downfall of General Amin in 1979. In April 1986, Ukele Togo once again was forced to go into exile. And this time, he sought asylum in London, in England, where he lived with his family until he returned to Uganda in January 1995. He was a professional pilot, I think one of the best pilots Uganda has produced, as well as an aeronautical engineer. But above all, Togo was a devoted Christian. He was also a keen golfer, and in fact, he was president of the Uganda Golf Union. I believe he served that position twice. Ukele Togo was married to Miss Resty Karugonjo on March 4th, 1972 at the All Saints Cathedral in Nakasero in Kampala. And that is the spiritual home of the family. And as was Dennis Redden mentioned, Togo was blessed with 5 children, 3 boys and 2 girls. And Sandra was Baston, Dennis, Nicholas, Emily, and Joshua. The 4 children currently live in the UK. According to Mrs. Resty Togo, Ukele Togo was a kind and loving husband, as well as a caring father, something which I can witness myself. He loved his children and the grandchildren whose names have been mentioned. He was always available for his family. He was an exemplary and persevering man. And he always seemed to be clear in his mind on what he wanted to achieve in life. On that tragic day in 2002, when Brigadier Togo passed on, I was in Kampala. And as it was my tradition, I went for Sunday service for all the All Saints Cathedral in Nakasero. And was present for the Union of Prayer. The Golf Union held a one-day tournament, followed by a big reception in the memory of Ukele Togo. Factive role in effort to normalize then volatile political situation in Uganda. Any of you who was there during that time, that was one of the most difficult times in the history of Uganda. And when eventually it was possible to arrange peace talks between the government and the NRM, General Tito Okello appointed Togo to be the leader of the government delegation to narrow the peace talks. One of them, I'm being warned that my time is up. Not exactly. One of the members of the delegation is here with us, one of the 89, will discuss that part of the Togo's role. But as a man who was personally committed to such a peace in Uganda, Togo played a leading role in ensuring in order to withdraw of Unilever and Tuna Talks in Kampala in January 1986 to avoid an unnecessary reaction loss of lives and destruction of property. Doko was an exemplary leader who served Uganda diligently, honestly, and to the best of his ability. Uganda Doko was a patriot and a nationalist who lived and struggled relentlessly for peace, unity, prosperity, and security of the people of Uganda. He also believed in the unity of the people of Israel. Sadly, the day we saw the Bible. When we were going to school in Gulu, my classmates, they used to think that Western was like most Ugandan districts, of sister of one tribe, and baked in the Ugandan system too. Virtually all the districts were carved along the tribal line, except West Nile, the Gezi, and what was then in the okay. We had four tribes here, four main tribes, and so I remember one friend of mine from Nigeria, he asked me, said, why do you only talk to your brother from West Nile in English? Well, one of my classmates, one of our classmates was Landau, another was Kapwa, another man. So I said, we don't speak the same language. I was so surprised that we were so united. We used to go to Gulu in a bus. We used to go in a special bus from Arua to Gulu, and the bus would come and pick us from school and bring us. Nobody would pick someone to come and say, oh, the bus. Although the night came when the bus would come at night. But we are not many. So Doko was committed to peace West Nile and in Uganda. I remember when I was in Canada in 1990, there was a conference which was organized by a Canadian organization about Uganda. And Doko came from Uganda with the political man of publicity and some Ugandans from Sweden and all of it. And we had a very good conference. They could spend a few days with me before they came back to Uganda. So his commitment to peace has always been the central aspect of his work. And as I say, my colleague, Honorable Dignan, from my NBOA constituency, will discuss the important role that we will talk about today. First, at the MOSH Unit Conference in 1999, which I made it attended. Then that period, we called the Union Act, and then in 1985, we discussed. In January 1995, we gave a talk about Dan Torua. Down to Uganda after almost 10 years of exile in London. I was then in Canada. He called me and asked me to accompany him. Then most of my friends in Canada were sort of reluctant to go. They thought I was saying no. I said, no, I trust all these things are coming up. So we came with him and accompanied him with Mr. Kalevu Dite Kamure, that was his around. Yes, I was in London. Then Mr. Henry Aloha, who was a pilot in Ghana, but not in the past. So we came here in 1995 in general, two of us, well received, well looked after. We came up the road, went to Marara, went to Bali, Jinja, and Gulu. And so what we saw convinced him that he can come back, which he did towards the end of that year. Now, when Doko returned in 1995, he decided to retire from politics and focus his energies on business, private sector. He planned to start and operate a regional airline to solve the Great Lakes issue. And in fact, he prepared a comprehensive business plan, which he shared with me. And they contacted a Canadian company called Bombardier, provided the main means for the French planes. They contacted Bombardier, and they were willing to buy the lease of selling aircraft for him to operate in the region. But for the venture to take off, you needed support from government or from the Bank of Uganda as a guarantor, which was promised. But unfortunately, based on my knowledge, the promise had not yet materialized by August 2002. And this was really the cause of a project. And sadly, he has not been seen the night of day. I hope that Dennis will pull up his mantle in due course. Toko also planned to write a book about the 1985 Nairobi talks, between the Military Commission and the National Resistance Army. The peace talks were pretty successful in December 1985, but unfortunately, the agreement was still born and I was never implemented. As I said, it's a big man with important this. The talk on the peace talks would have been to call second. His first book is entitled Intervention in Uganda, the Power Struggle and Soviet Involvement, which he wrote in the United States when he was in exile. I'm advised that there may be some copies of that book available. He said that it's a very good reading book, which is worth acquiring if one wants to know the background to what Uganda has gone through. Although Toko was a positive and friendly force of the Military Council, he was rather unfairly blamed for some of the excesses of military. See, Toko didn't join the Military Council because he didn't present any of the fighting forces. We had a group called FUNA and I think even as a commissioner. But he was not really new them, of course. But he was appointed in the Military Commission in a personal capacity. So, the persons who were blaming for, well, you know, the number of the record was I believe that history will judge the talk of February and recall that he played a constructive role as Vice President of Uganda during a difficult and trying time. Toko was always conscious of the fact that power ultimately belongs to God, as Scripture says. Hence, power must be exercised for the glory of God and for the best interests of the people of God, people of Uganda, and not for personal gain, as sadly appears to be the case in many African countries today. If you doubt what I'm saying, read Psalm 62, where it says, more than once I've heard God say that power belongs to him and that his love is constant. You yourself, O God, reward everyone according. So what our constitution says that power belongs to people is only true in the sense that the voice of the people is the voice of God, the right voice of the people. So the people are speaking in behalf of God. Nobody should say it has power belongs to God. If you abuse it, you will see God will punish you. Make no mistake. Toko has left a powerful and enduring legacy of dedicated and selfless service to Uganda, which all of us should try to emulate, especially those who are in the world of politics. Unlike many contemporary politicians, and even some in private life, Toko was an honest man, he was a man of courage and integrity, a man of principle. He did not sit on the fence or blow with the wind or blindly follow the majority, teeming on what Scripture calls the wide road. And I know where it is. Take the narrow road, don't call it the wide road. Toko did not shy away from making difficult and hard choices and decisions. His decision to return to Uganda in 1995 was in fact very controversial among the Western community in London, where he lived for 10 years. Many of them said, no, don't come. In fact, when we went back from Uganda, I think it was in February or beginning of January, March 1995. We called a meeting in London of the Western community to brief them on what we saw and what we experienced. And it was quite a stormy meeting. I'm not being named, but there are people who were not being convinced. They didn't believe what was telling them. And I tell you, in Canada, there are many people who believe that anything good from in Canada. Which is very sad. I believe that West Nile and Uganda needs men and women of Tokyo's caliber in leadership at all levels, in both public sector and private sector. Men and women of courage, of integrity, of self-confidence, who cannot be corrupted by money or material things which are of no consequence for the greater good of the people of Uganda and our region. An ancient Greek philosopher called Pericles argued long ago that the secret of liberty or freedom is courage. Lack of courage is often the missing link between freedom, oppression, and unrighteousness of freedom. That, my friends, I believe is the daunting task which we challenge which we face today. I hope all of us, especially young people, can rise to the challenge and hear the cry of our people for freedom, for justice, for peace, and for prosperity for all citizens of the country. For God and my country, may the Lord have mercy on us.
Late into life, time, and seminal service of God Lewis in Tokyo to this country in various areas from aviation to political leadership. You have also done justice, particularly to a topic that was without borders. Now that you have opened the pages, the next phase is where a four-person panel will subsequently provide a rejoinder and specifically dissect that presentation and provide additional sprinkling of information that serves as a takeaway for those of us who are gathered here. And certainly, as has been wished by the organizers and the family, the purpose is to celebrate the life of God Wilson Tokyo and the enduring values that he cherished and lived should serve as the key takeaways at the end of this. So we are going to the phase of introducing the four panelists, and all of them are present. I will start with Big Nyan. Of course, that's a very familiar name, particularly if you come from this part of the country, or even indeed nationally for the service rendered. For the purpose of this particular function, and as a panelist, Big Nyan has preferred to be introduced as a friend of God, and as a friend of the family, an elder who currently is the speaker of the local Kari. Dick, of course, came from West Nile, and faith bonded him with God in more ways than one. When Toko was the general manager of Uganda Airlines, Dick was a member of the board of the airlines. And when Toko became the Director General of the East African East African Airways, Dick was a staff of the East African Common Market Secretariat. So that history anchors the basis on which Dick has been invited to provide a rejoinder to the presentation by Ambassador Harold Achema. In summary, Dick is a former teacher, a journalist, international civil servant, and politician. His paper is specifically supposed to flag for us the seminal role that God played in motion, which was the hub for Uganda's political exiles, And as well as Guard's role as head of the government delegation to the Nairobi Peace Talks, which, as we all know, ended up with President Museveni taking power in 1986.
Ladies and gentlemen, I also have the honor to introduce one of our very distinguished panelists, Major General Joshua Masara. I'll ask Major that you wave to the ladies and gentlemen who are looking at you. Major General Masara is the commander to Uganda Aviation Academy in Akasongola. That is why he's serving currently. And he lived and worked with the late Brigadier Guard Wilson Doko in the 1970s. So he's here in various capacities, one as a friend, but also as somebody who worked with the late and has a record of his work in the Air Force. And in his own words, allow me to echo, this is why I'm here as a representative of the Air Force. And I believe he's here in that capacity. And his paper will specifically share his experience in working with the late, something that, ladies and gentlemen, we can learn from in terms of shaping our working life as we live our life in serving this nation.
Panelist three is Ambassador Ernest Obiche Gama. Ambassador Obiche Gama is an elder statesman, is a former senior military officer, and a retired ambassador. Obiche Gama retired at the rank of Lieutenant Colonel. He served as Uganda's ambassador to the post in Tokyo, taking charge of the affairs for South Korea. He was later posted to Rome and appointed to two international organizations, which are agencies of the United Nations. He retired in 1995 after serving in Khartoum. Of course, Obiche Gama comes from Maracha, for all of us who may wish to know, and he has a depth of knowledge that we think will provide a well-rounded grounding in terms of his relations with the family and in profession.
And lastly, ladies and gentlemen, our panelist four is Dr. Charles Ezo Andi. He is a UK-trained retired senior consultant dental surgeon. He has worked in various portfolios. First, he was appointed as the government's dental surgeon in charge of Nile province in 1973. And later, he was also appointed as a consultant with the World Health Organization back its Lymphoma project, which worked in West Nile in 1975 to 1980. He was later promoted as a senior government surgeon and worked tirelessly to establish the School of Dentistry in the Faculty of Medicine in Makerere University that stands until this day. He left Uganda and, of course, Mulago Hospital in 1981 and relocated to London, where he lives until this day. While in the UK, he has also served in the National Health Services in different capacities as a registrar, senior registrar, consultant, dental surgeon, and he also ran his own private dental practice until 2010. He's married, he has four children, and these children, the two are medical consultants, and then the other is senior lecturers in London University. He's here to speak in two capacities as a friend of the late Brigadier Wilson Doko, but also as somebody who spent a lot of time with the late when he lived in London. So he's going to talk to us more about that part of his life and his legacy that we feel is very useful for this very important and historic day.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming Big Nyai, who we have authorized to speak from where he is seated. Thank you.
In 2014, so I find it very difficult to stand up. In Fort Porto, they said he read the new vision this morning. He heard I was going to talk today. I should bring his greetings to you people because Brigadier Toho was his brother in law. And I think I'm above at that meeting. Do I take it back? Then I got another greeting from someone in Moyo, He said, let us remember to hope with kindness and asking ourselves, what shall we leave behind? These are very difficult questions. Now, I have been all sorts of things at different times, so I decided not to write a speech. I will talk, and the reporters will tell me when I talk too much, they can shut me up. I'll be flexible. But I want to bring the background to certain of the things in which Brigadier Toko took place. Some of you in the Air Force, who are old enough, remember Brigadier Guard Wilson Toko, as he was commonly called Captain, because he was a captain for a long time. Even when he went to East African Airways as a Director General, people still called him Captain. Now, you know, Ambassador Harold Achema, your father and Toko's father took the correct course in serving God. He grounded you in religion and you found your own way. Now, very few of you here have been to Paraga. It's a this desolate place out of nowhere. But coming from there and going to Sir Samuel Becker, which at the time was one of the first few government-aided, government-built secondary schools. And those days, the going to secondary school was not by accident. It was by competition. I think Dr. Nee is here, my friend, Lieutenant Colonel of Integama is here, because this one we shared. We shared classrooms at some time. In those days, if you did not pass, you are dead. Finished. And in those days, religion was a matter of cardinal importance. If you are a Catholic, then you go to Niapea, where my neighbor here went. If you're a Protestant, then you can go to Arua Junior Secondary School. And put it this way, these young people, put this carefully. You have a lot of primary schools, and Arua Junior Secondary School was taking 50 people in a year. So all of you who passed grade 1 in P7, come again to Bara and then sit another examination. I think in our year we are about 5 times in the past for 50 places. And at that time, the competition was not between you and the, does the teacher like me or not. It's between you and your neighbor who must beat you. For instance, Dickie and myself, I caught my elder brother, Ronald Nathan Badanyanya, in P5. And we wound up with him. And every time we went for exams, I'll tell you, I'll beat you. There's no choice about it. When we were in J2A, the late Miss Margaret Lloyd was a very good teacher. The 26 of us, 25 of us, would bunch up in group from number 1 to 6. They are finished. Number 1 is Abiko, number 2 is Nguma, number 3 there are about 3 other names, number 4 there are 4 other names, and number 5, 6, finished. We were competing against each other. Nowadays, I hear children, I know my house is on the road. My father has a car. My father has a boda-boda. Is that yours? Don't make what your father make you. Make yourself. And from Sir Samuel Baker, Brigadier Toko went to the Air Force. He very well trained everywhere, Russia, Italy. Czechoslovakia. And Italy and USA. And he became the best of the best. Yes. Yesterday I was saying on radio, a low band, that I believe at that time Brigadier Guard Wilson Toko was the best Air Force pilot Uganda has ever produced. May the Air Force officers here, they may correct me. And from that basis, having competed, then General Idi Amin gets power. He decides he doesn't want noisy people like Toko around him. Let him push him away, send him to Nairobi as the Director General of East African Airways. And that is fitting in a new society. Not of the Maratha, not of the Lopara, not of the white Ugandans, but of the larger community of Kenya, Tanzania, and all other peoples, where they came through. And Brigadier Toko fitted very well. In the Communications Council, he used to deliberate very effectively. Why? For the simple reason, some of you young people should learn one thing. Don't be proud of yourself. Lose your pride. Be humble and accommodating. Look out, reach out to people. Because with Brigadier Toko, we used to say, if you want something from somebody, you should cook that person. Give him everything he wants. Praise his name, even if it's right. And Brigadier Toko wanted the best for himself. His wife there, Rosie, is the daughter of an engineer. I don't know whose wife you are going to marry. That is the engineer's daughter, and he kept her very well. And maybe I'm going to say this today. Rest is forgiving. I believe Rest is alive because Brigadier Toko's reactions were very fast. I think when he realized he was going into an accident, he must have pushed Rest's head out of the dashboard. I may be wrong. But there were only two in that car, and one lives, one is not alive. Now, there are questions, how did Toko die? There are various stories. Toko escorted the then Bishop of Madian Western Diocese, Reverend Lee Gatti, to Entebbe Airport to take an early morning flight to Arua. And then he was a starter for a golf tournament in Jinja. So he came back to Bunga, and that's a very difficult road to negotiate. Then he picked his wife, Renzi, and said, let's now head for Jinja. The stories were that
After Kaworo, as we start going downward, a pickup came suddenly in front of him, billowing a lot of smoke, and he could not go fast. Then when he got an opportunity to pass, he stepped on the pedal and went on the right. By the time he was coming back to his side, they had run into this car. Because Justice Kania's wife had also left Ginger in a double cabin pickup. She was heading from Barara for a court session on Monday. So these are two people in a hurry, and they met and they remained there. Now, some of you say, why did Toko go to Moshi Conference? Toko was Director General of East African Airways. Some of you may know that around that time, late K. Amin passed on under very mysterious circumstances. And Toko, Brigadier Toko, is a cousin to late K. And the other one, the doctor from Ginger, Dr. Kuga, were also here. And let him come on Doga, also made a tragic death. So when the mean says you are not welcome home, I think Toko knew what he was waiting for him. But by then I was in Arusha. Brigadier General Idi Amin decided to attack Tanzania. He went into the Kagera Salient, crossed over, and there was a big, big sugar plantation. Kakira is nothing. Sangobe. And they set it on fire. And killed some people and wrote their names in blood on the walls. So the Tanzanians said, enough is enough. This snake, we shall kill it, we'll chase it, we'll look for it. We can ponda ponda, we can miniga, we can tupa injil. And the whole of Tanzania moved to a war footing. People, a rich person here with a lorry, would fill his lorry with fuel, get 10 drums, fill them with fuel, and take them to the army. Said, go to the front. But there was another question. If the Tanzanian army came to Uganda, defeated Idi Amin, then what would be the next thing? And then, do you have nature hates a vacuum. So the Tanzanians said, look, you Ugandans who are in exile, you are complaining, you are doing this. Why don't you come to Moshi? We are giving you a platform. You write your agreement. So when we defeat Idi Amin, there will be a government in waiting. That's exactly what they did. They took a little bit of time about it. You know, the lawyers here, they like what, where of, wherefore, whereby. I think Ben Mkapa, who was then Minister for Foreign Affairs, came to Moshi and told me, you are talking about these legal niceties, but our people are dying. If you don't finish up, we'll put you in a plane, we'll take you to a table, we'll finish it there. I can assure you that did wonders. Moshi agreement was breached. Those people were put in the plane, drawn to Dar es Salaam, to the old police officer's mess, waiting for the ouster of Idi Amin. At that time, Dick Nyang was Richard Anguyo. I was in Renew Tanzania, and even in 1979, when Lule was being announced president, This is Radio Uganda, Uganda, Kampala. That announcement was made by me from Dar es Salaam. We're tied the room. So certain things happen. You look for good things, you don't come there. You look for bad things, sometimes you get them. But some of you must know this history. In 1979, when Professor Yusuf Lule came to Radio Tanzania to record his speech, there was one speech in English which was drafted and approved by President Nyerere. Then he was supposed to translate it in Uganda. Once he had read the English speech, he departed from that completely and went into to I started crying in that studio. So this Tanzanian said, why are you crying? I said, your people from Bukoba in Nyerere's state house, take this tape in, let them listen to it. They took that tape, they listened to it, they empowered the term. That's not going out. I think some people, more knowledge than me, will know that during the Moshi agreement, it was agreed that if Yusuf Lule was removed, the next person as president would be Akena Pajok. Some of you know him. He was a boy here, he grew up with us. He was in Barra Junior Secondary School. Yeah? And but at that time, you know, Yusuf Lule decided to copy his predecessor, General Idi Amin. He went to the NCC and told them, I'll act first and discuss later. So these people said, what is this? We are supposed to be a parliament. You say you'll act first and discuss later. So they wanted to dismiss him. In that struggle, some of you officers will know that there are Tanzanians at State House and Tete. They sat there through the NCC meeting the whole day and through the night. And Lule told them to arrest these people. They said, no, in our place in Tanzania, you don't arrest them, peace. MPs discuss and you leave them to go. They talked, they finished in the morning. They said, Yusuf Lule, you are no longer president. So what next? Then people said, I cannot go job by motion. They said, that's in a jolly, meet him out. So that is hard for another Muganda. Now, my late friend, Geoffrey Binaisa, had traveled from America to Kampala. He was hoping to get a job as ambassador in the court of St. James. That's Britain. Things were difficult. I can assure you people are just laughing now. When we were in 89, things were difficult. Some of us who were smoking wrecks, if you didn't know somebody working with it, BAT, you don't get wrecks. Yes. 79. You don't get wrecked. And so, Geoffrey Binaisa goes to Nairobi, I don't know whether to shop. When he was on his way back, the people sent cars from Entebbe to look for him. They found him somewhere along between Jinja and the border, then brought him to the hotel in Jinja and attired him properly and took him to Entebbe. He said, you are now president. President, I'm saying this because I was there in the first dinner in Israel in nine marches. I was at that table along with God Wilson Toko. There were 11 of us from different tribes. I think only two local, too much represented. So when the Baganda saw this, they said, this fellow, he cannot be a good Muganda. This is Benisa. You can see what it means. You take a good name, Benisa, to Benisa. This is Isa's son. You don't know him. So, Benisa was sworn in the president. Then there are some people who know that those were a lot of Americans who were staying somewhere in safe house. Some of them were looking like Italians. So, and Benisa had strange ideas about his priority was getting another underground railway tunnel for Kampala when there was no food in Kampala. That he was going to fly 250 tons of beer from London. Uganda Breweries was producing almost less than 10%. So eventually, you know, they say, and he himself said it, said the seat is sweet. He now started enjoying the presidency. Said, I'll now do what I want. So what do I do next? I'm going to sign. Oye, Brigadier Oye, Ojok, as ambassador to Algeria. I'm going to post this on so and so, sir. And removing all the people who are in Moshi so that you have power. This is the time when he called late Brigadier Guy Wilson Toko, and I don't know whether Honorable Basu was here, you bear me witness. We drove Toko to State House, and he next appointed him Minister of Transport. That never came to be, because that night was overthrown. So we had this military commission, jazz and so on. Eventually, we came to the military council. Now, I believe Brigadier Toko knew how to play poker. Some of you know what poker is. A card game where you keep your cards close to your chest. You don't show your cards to anybody. He was the general manager of Uganda Airlines. He decides we are flying to Dubai to see the operations of our airline in Dubai. How are they working with their counterparts? Because in Dubai, you don't work in Dubai without an Arab citizen as your partner. And our partner was actually a brother to the Sultan of Dubai. So we flew that morning, we landed in Indian, we went to Apollo, we went to International Hotel, slept very well. In the morning, we went to meet our colleague, and when we came back to the hotel at about 12 o'clock, we found the hotel manager standing on the front of the hotel, arms akimbo, and as we got out of the car, he said, we are government, as we overthrown. You said not to solve this. Then at 3 p.m., there came a call that they wanted to talk to Brigadier Toko. And Brigadier Wilson Toko said he was not taking that call. Can I take it for him? So I took that call for him, and it was from Francis Obida, calling from General Tito Kelo's office.
Moi
influence Tito to withdraw Togo. But before he went, Togo did one thing. He said, Dinya, you know, tomorrow morning, we are going to have a breakfast with President Moi. I said, at what time? He said, 4:30 a.m. Some of you here are very happy you want to become president. You know the hours you keep. The unholy hours. So we went to this breakfast. And Brigadier Togo asked Moi, what do you really want the Ghana government to do? Moi was simple, a tribalistic thing, because the Popes have been here are related to Kalenjin, then appoint many of them as ministers. And Togo said, fine, now the best of them is here in Nairobi. Can we take the personnel manager of the American tire company and make him ambassador? And the boy said, no, this one is mine. But we went back to Kampala. The rest, well, Nairobi talks were taking place, President Museveni was getting time to get his troops together, and he pushed. Now, the thing I'm going to talk as Speaker of Lubarakari is this. When Museveni took over Kampala, there was some pandemonium. People left in disarray. And Togo drove through Jinja, I think in the company of Major Toroko and Major Chako, and it was a deadly thing. Then when they arrived in Gulu, there was another meeting. Then Togo said, if you want us to go back and regroup and go and fight, he said that. Let me first go to Arua and consult the elders. And he came and consulted the elders in White Rhino Hotel. And the elders told him, our son, thank you for bringing your trouble to us. We cannot say yes or no, but we say this, when you go to this war, don't kill any person who is not armed. 2, don't loot. 3, don't kill any Acholi. So he said, now what commission? And I think my brother here was in that meeting. He had traveled from Kampala. He'll take me his own story. I think I've talked too long, but I won't say this. Children, look for your own life. Yesterday is history. Tomorrow is a memory. All you have to live is today. I thank you.
In the name of Air Force Commander, who was invited to be on this occasion, and because of his other duties, he was unable. But he requested me to come on his behalf, and the good thing about this is that I worked with our friend, our commander, right from the time he joined up to the time he left Air Force, when he had been appointed to Nairobi as the general manager of East African Airways. As Air Force, we knew about Togo as early as 1963-64. So this is the area I'm going to talk about because he was in the Air Force, later on he left and he started doing the political work with the different players. So that part of it, I'm not going to go into it. But I'm only concentrating on the area when he was in the Army, in the Air Force, until he left. Brigadier Toko joined in 1963, and as usual, when you come in the Air Force, you have to go through the Army. You are recruited as a soldier, and you undergo basic military training, which lasts between 9 months to 1 year. And that is what we normally do, all of us, whether you're in the Army, whether you're in the Air Force, that's what happens. So when he was recruited in 1963, he went in the Army, he trained approximately 1 year, then he was inducted to Air Force training. And that year, he was sent abroad to Soviet Union, which now you call Russia. It was called the Soviet Socialist Republic of Russia. So that's where he went. But we had two groups. There was another group which went to Czechoslovakia, the present Czech Republic. These groups were doing piloting and engineering as technicians for aircrafts. For him, I don't know whether they went through the, because there are rigorous tests they do before they start. That one was done in Russia. So he had to go through all those tests they normally do. And in Uganda, we knew that there were people training in Soviet Union as pilots and engineers on MiG-15, MiG-17. These are aircraft which were bought by the country, and the pilots were supposed to train first before they are delivered. We didn't have the aircraft here, but they were still in Russia. So the course was for 3 years, and that's what he did with the others. Some were pilots, some were technicians. While they were there, we had another course behind here, and that's the one I joined in 1966. We were also doing offline in Entebbe, being trained by Israelis. There they were being trained by Russians, and the other group was in Czechoslovakia, being trained by Czechs. In 1968, that's when they finished their training. It was a 3 year course, leading the diploma in aircraft maintenance and flight. So they came back in 1968. And they were posted to Gulu. They were stationed in Gulu with their aircrafts. And the group also called Czechoslovakia came back. And for us who are training in Entebbe, we also finished our course. Ours was 2 year course. We finished, and my first deployment was in Gulu. I moved to Gulu, and that's when I met our friend Toko as a pilot on MiG-15-17. MiG-15 is a trainer aircraft, and MiG-17 is a combat aircraft. So they were using that one for training and MiG-17 for combat, for fighting. So he was a fighter pilot. They continued. Now, of course, when they are inside against, there's a war. But if there's no war, they just continue flying, practicing. As they say, practice makes perfect. So when you keep flying every day, you become more experienced. So they remained there flying. And when I was also posted to Guru, I also went with my type of aircraft I was playing on, because ours was Israeli type, and I was posted to Guru to do liaison work. And later on, I joined a group of Czechoslovakia, because they were also there with their aircraft here of 29, and we continued flying. I joined that one to do training also, because I had finished with the Piper, and I was now doing another step. So we remained there working. Now, later on, in 1970, the government of Uganda bought more aircraft, but this time MiG-21. When the government paid for the aircraft in Russia, Toko with other officers, other pilots, with some technicians, were selected and sent back to Russia to do a conversional course on this particular aircraft. Course is more superior, it's faster. It's the latest aircraft we had by that time in the 70s. That was the best combat aircraft. So Toko went with the others, they did the training. Now, while they were still there, in 1971, that was the coup, when Idi Amin took the government, overthrew Dr. Milton Obote, and these people were trapped. They were there, they had finished their training, but they were not able to come back. Because of the rumor, because of what they were hearing. A coup, you know, people, it wasn't a good thing. Everybody feared. We lost some people around. So when they had this, some people didn't want to come back. But Toko, with others, almost half-half, he said, come back. When they reached Entebbe airport, there was serious screaming. But thank God, Toko sailed through with some technicians, some pilots. They were brought back to Gulu. Now, few months after, their aircraft, which they went to train on, were delivered. But this time, they were stationed in Entebbe. Instead of Guru. So these people had to come back to Entebbe. They assembled the aircraft and they start flying. They continued with their training. Because remember, the training you do out there is not enough. As you come back with your aircraft, you continue training. So they remained in Entebbe and they were trained continuously. And in 1871, around May, June, I left Entebbe. I went out to Italy for a course. Tokos were still behind here at Entebbe. For them, they were ready for an eventuality, because these are combat pilots. They are called upon when there's war to go and fight. When I was out, Toko was appointed commander of the Air Force. I stayed in Israel for about 7 months. I came back and I said, in another 2 months I went to USA for training. When I was there, that's when I had, Toko had been moved out of Air Force and he was appointed general manager of East African Airways. That's how we were disconnected. Definitely as Air Force, we really lost out. Toko was one of the pilots, the best friends we had. Because I remember one day, he flew a minister, of defense, and in a jet fighter. You know, it's not easy, because this aircraft, when you go in there, you have to harness yourself, you tie yourself on the seat. So when he does the aerobatics, you don't roll out of the aircraft. So he took the minister and made the maneuvers. When he came back, the minister was sweating. He said, this is what we really tell you, that when we ask for some good allowance or some good salary, we are not enjoying life. It is tough. It's tough. Actually, he flew the Minister of Defense. Because this is when they were trying to ask for better pay, better remuneration. So he was a very, very good pilot. So when they took him out, we felt we have lost. This is personal. When he was at this, Air Force commander, you know that he is with us, he can always advise. Even if he's not flying, but he can always advise. Because he had a very strong knowledge on the aircrafts, and he was very good in combat pilot. So, this is the area I remember very well when we were with Toko. He was so good. He was a person who understands a problem. You can always discuss. And we missed him. But then when he went out, suddenly, during 1976, during the Israel raid in Entebbe, when the terrorists brought in some hostages, Toko was still in the lobby. And when these terrorists passed, the Israeli commandos passed through Nairobi, they came to Entebbe, they rescued the hostages. Amin was very furious. He said, why Toko is in Nairobi? How does these people pass without him seeing and informing me in time? And that's because, that's the reason why he decided to fire him. He said he doesn't want him there. And therefore, I think they got another general manager. And the good thing that Toko did not come back, because if he came back, definitely, I mean, his tempers, he could have done anything to him. He was not an easy person to go with. So we really appreciated that move when Toko decided to go away. In exile. No, exile is not a good place to stay, but at least you can save your life when you are there. And later in life, you can come back. And indeed, he came back during the Tito Okelosi government, and later on, he was in the peace talks in Nairobi, and he was made even the Minister of Defense. So that is much I know about him. But see, the time Dr. Toko was came back, the army and the air force, which is served, which it belonged to, because the Uganda Air Force, these two institutions were known for, because they had been disbanded by the UNL government. When the UNL government came in, they said, we don't need this army, but it's the army, don't they are the ones who killed the people. So they were disbanded, all the soldiers, all everybody, including the pilots, were trained. The government had lost a lot of money. These people just vanished. They were nowhere to be found. And that's because a government is a government. But if this one is removed, the law comes, and the people who are trained belong to the government, to the state. They don't belong to individuals. So this is a problem we had. There was no problem back. There was no pilot, there was no technician, there was nobody. Even the army, the entire army, was lost. So that is not much I can say, but it's a very. The others, I think I've had these panels telling you the other political stories. That is not my area. So I'll say, the other part is left memories of comradeship, class warfare, inspirational leadership, and professionalism in the Air Force. It's a very, very well remembered. For his talent services, not only in Uganda Air Force, but also national and international affairs. May God grant him a lasting peace.
You share with me my experiences in the United Kingdom when the Joko came in exile the second time. Most of the things have already been said, unless somebody mentioned in England, time is money, so I'm going to be very short. There are a few things that haven't been highlighted yet, but I will add them as I go along. I first met Toko in Uganda High Commission in London when he was there, been in exile for a long time. And after that, he told me to take him to various places, and within a short time, I learned how much people he had known in the United Kingdom. Not only the Ugandans, but British, Irish, French, and so on. Everybody welcomed him, and his motto at that time was, he was there for his family. So he concentrated on his family, forgot about politics, and later, however, he found himself among a group of West Nilers. And with his help and others, we formed what was today called West Nile Welfare Association. He was an inspiration, particularly in England. People think England is very, very, it's like heaven, but I can tell you it is a mix of heaven and hell. It depends on where. Men, particularly, you could find yourself somebody's wife if you don't know what you're doing. And ladies get very, very, very irritating, and they assume so much power because the law supports them. And on exile, you know, whether they had O levels or A levels, but it didn't matter. Because once there, you can always find your way to university. So we used to organize social functions, raise money, which will help those who were in financial difficulties, which will help if we lost a person and we have to return the body home, and so on. But Toko was the spearhead. Toko was the man for it. The West Nile Welfare Association became so successful that other Ugandan communities, either tribally, regionally, and so on, actually copied the West Nile Welfare Association constitution. And they started their own. And these organizations could meet and so on. But I think at the end of the day, I would say, this was one way of actual help to bring Ugandans in exile together. It could be in peaceful of political change in Uganda, etc. He being somebody very keen to give democracy and so on, he realized that there was no point for him to stay in exile if he didn't want to put an impact on the Czech political and democratic changes in Uganda. So he decided to come. Some of the Western Welfare Association members did not agree, but the majority did support his coming. And indeed, he returned. One of the things that was manpower, training, and so on. But all this needed the permission of the government at home. Of course, when he came in, he presented this document, and of course, as you know, up to today, we never got anything out of it. Another thing he thought of was to empower the youngsters of Uganda, not only West Nile, but Uganda, by establishing a computer school. Those of you who are in Arua know we had Northwestern College of Computing. The idea was, with so many youngsters dropping out after O-level, A-level, or even completing university at that time, as we had, these people were jobless. And this IT industry was just beginning to mushroom in the West. So Toko, being foresighted, looked at this and said, why don't we take this home and start helping these youngsters, particularly those that could not go beyond. So the school was started, but unfortunately, with the tragic death of his, it collapsed, and there was no somebody to encourage or motivate others. So that's basically the few things I would like to say about Brigadier Guard Wilson Toko. Finally, you may not, it has not been mentioned, after leaving Kampala Technical Institute, Toko wanted to be a pilot. He went to the East African Airways that was dominated by the whites. They looked at him and said, no, 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 you can't manage this. Africans cannot manage it. So he ended up, I think, doing aircraft engineering. His luck came when the Ugandan government wanted to establish an air force. And he came back and he joined, and you know the story. While he was training in England, during his second exile, a lot of his colleagues came, and we used to meet them together. And they were talking of how excellent he was a pilot, what was flying the Royal Air Force. Some of them even wanted him to join the British Royal Air Force. But he said, no, he had so many hours out of flying, so he couldn't manage. So he didn't join them. Another thing was, when he was training on MiG-15 and 17 in the Soviet Union, he maneuvered the MiG-17 so well that the Soviets allowed him, as a foreigner, to test fly MiG-19 and MiG-21, which were at that time solely for the Soviet Union Air Force. He performed so well that this communist Soviet country wanted him to become a citizen of the Soviet Union, but he turned that request down for his beloved Uganda. Brigadier Toko has served this country with integrity. His legacy should inspire the young generation for greater things in life and ethical leadership. May God let his soul rest in peace. Amen.
Also as a pillar of unity, even when he was not in this country, a man who left footprints wherever he went. He was in London, but they speak of him like there was a ruler in London. Most importantly, what stood out is the Western Welfare Association. I hope the Western Foundation members who are here will have some lessons to pick from that kind of work. And also a man who did not forget where he came from. Even when he was away, he remembered and asked himself what he wanted to do for the young people here. That is a challenge to most of us who are not here. You must think about what do you want to do for your people back home. And with that, we'll now have our very last panelist who is going to wrap up these presentations in the next 10 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to welcome the retired Lieutenant Colonel Ambassador Ernest Obichogama, who is a distinguished son of the soil, and he's going to guest us with this presentation to wrap up what the rest of the panelists have said. You're welcome, Ambassador.
It means all what I wanted to talk has already been talked. And I had prepared myself to talk, but I'm not going to talk as I prepare, but I'm going to go through as a summary. The organizers, I think, have been very, very unfair to me to put me last, because what I'm going to say is the beginning of Tokoh's life. The beginning of Tokoh's life. All it's what they have said is what he has done, but you cannot do before you start. So I'm going to concentrate on Tokoh's childhood up to the time he joined the Army and the Air Force, and also the second encounter as during the Tito administration, and also the last time when I was in London with him. As it has been said, Tokoh was born in January 1943. I was born in 1940. I'm older by 3 years. Tokoh went to school before me because his father was a lay reader. 3 years before me. He came to Mara Junior Secondary School as stated by Dickey before me. I think about 3 years before me. Tokoh went to Southern Baker School before I went to Mwiri, Musoro College in Mwiri, 3 years later. So, because the earlier days were from grammar school, from various schools, because the father was a lay reader, he studied in various grammar schools, but ended in Mwiri. But my contact with him was when I was in Musoro College in Mwiri. Then after my comrade, I joined the army before Tokoh joined the army, because Tokoh went to KTI for 2 years, then went to East Africa Airways for another 2 years before he joined the Air Force. So my contact with him was a student. It was so close at that time. But later, when he joined the Air Force, as my colleague was talking, he joined the Air Force precisely in July 1964. 1964, he joined the Air Force as army, as he talked about, as a military. He trained as a military, an engineer with the other groups. But during that time, it was, of course, intention to do piloting, but this piloting was an issue that the African Ugandan could not fly aircraft. As it was said that for any African Ugandan to fly an aircraft, it would not take less than 15 years. And of course, we had already had independence. Some of you know our political problems. There was the Western imperialism, the communists. So there was a fight. So when Uganda got its independence in 64, Britain left, we had only one battalion, rifle battalion, no air force. So Uganda decided to establish the air force in 1964. They invited the Israelis to come to start the air force. The Israelis took time, they were very slow. And in July 1965, Obote, then Prime Minister, went to Soviet Union seeking places for better training and air force. And the permission was granted. And Tokos were then all taken. There were 80, 30 were air force, 50 were what we call infantry, the military part of it. So they were taken to that area and you training there. So that was the first contact I had with Toko, but not so close. But when I joined the army, the military, the infantry takes a shorter time. The Air Force takes about 2, 3, or 4 years. So my training was shorter, and then I got commissioned earlier. By the time Togo returned, in August 67, I was already working in the army headquarters as a director of training and operations, and it was me. And of course, that time with the Lord and Indian in the Central South, Togo was posted to Gulu to lead what they call MiG-17 Squadron. And the next one was L-27, which was of Czechoslovakia. Now, why? It was because the British were not happy for the Uganda to invite communist guys to come and train our guys. And they had the Israelis there. So the Israelis themselves didn't work well. So they wanted the communist guys to be separate, the others to be separate. So we had this competition. So the Russians, Czechoslovakians, trained this pastor, and within 2 years, and in 68, in August, there was a commission of the squadrons where Toko was the squadron leader, and they had to the air display in which the acrobatic what have you was done, which was witnessed by the head of state. That is what he said. That is the second encounter I had with Toko. The third one was when the governor of Peter Okello, when he was invited as the vice president, they had a problem. Museveni came, they had a problem. And they said, Museveni came in, Toko was shot, and the arm was injured. Later he came right after Angola. And our guys who were fighting, we are sitting, they were trying to organize themselves to go back to fight Museveni. But the elders of West Nile, I said West Nile, not Arua, West Nile, said no, we had enough of war. We don't want a war. If Museveni wants to let him come, we don't want to war. But in Kabbalah, we had problems. Rumors were so that people of West Nile were all killed. All the buildings were down. Late I went, and Aga the Bibi came to me, said, "Of the governor, you know Mr. Museveni, please come be our chairman. Organize and find out if our boys, these people who come from West Nile,
and Njinja, Lugazi, and Tembe, and Kamara, are they okay? I organized the meeting, and the police officers met in Kampala, asked each of the leaders they came to tell me what happened. They said everything was right. And it's unlike of the Tanzania who came, who killed the people West Nile, because they belonged here. But when Museveni came, there was no killing, unless it was by accident. Then I said, okay, if this is the case, let's continue. We were having meetings almost every other day, throughout, until a decision was made for me to fly to Arua via Congo. Those of you who were here, those of you who were alone, saw what happened in Paiterendo. I was being sought there several times. And I do not want to waste a lot of your time, since I've been warned that I don't continue. But the situation is that Tokoji Museveni came and we had a meeting here in Paiterendo. One during the meeting, after the meeting, I brought the minutes of our meetings in Kampala to continue the following day. And we're getting out. I was in Togo. Those of you who know Paiterendo, the back part there, where there is a borehole. So I was standing on one side, Togo was standing on the other side. We had this guy, this woman, or whatever they were, just opened the bus to us. Of course, we took cover. Of course, the rest is story. So it's a long story. To talk about Togo, for me, during that week, will take me about 2 or 3 days. So, the last one was in 1990, when I was ambassador in Khartoum. My daughter was studying his master's degree in London School of Economics. I decided to go and visit my daughter, and I went to my boy, Dr. Mejia, who lives in London. I went there. I saw my doctor. I said, okay, I want to go and talk to Togo. I said, he knew where he was talking. He took me and I went to Togo. I said, what's happening? Why don't you come home? Why are you here? He told me, he said, no. Yes, if you want me, come. I don't want to come, but if the people of West Nile, the elders of people of West Nile request me to come, I will come. I took that thing and said, I came back, I reported to the then Dr. Adjani and the wife, and the letter, the report went back, and the letter, he came. So, Brigadier Togo himself has been a man of integrity, a man very honest, hardworking, and as well a highly trained Air Force man and a disciplined person. We are going to miss him. Thank you very much.
His life is what is being celebrated today. Mercy is going to take us through the highlights, and afterward we will have a short musical interlude to enable us all to reflect on the conversation we have had and prepare contextualized questions that the panelists will have a few minutes to respond to before we go to the chief guest's speech.
Thank you very much, Tabo. I will just provide a summary of what came out of the discussions.